So, yeah, second last session of the day. Thank you so much, audience. I'd like to start quickly with just straight away going to the session topic, which is TV innovation. What does TV innovation mean to each one of you? Quickly get your mindset and just one line, not too long.
A new meaningful idea, which if implemented well, builds the brand's core.
Okay, excellent.
To me, it's experience along with the EQ, the emotional quotient.
Okay, very, very different and unique. Okay.
I think for me, it's aside to the novelty aspect, it solves a very specific problem for a brand or for a stakeholder of the brand.
Okay.
That's it.
Lakshmi?
Yeah. Hi, good evening. Innovation to me is progress. Innovation without a purpose has no meaning. And it has to be looked from each one's point of view, whether it's brand's point of view, whether what are they looking at in terms of progress.
Okay, not so lengthy. Thank you. But progress I take back. I think what Pamit and Mohit spoke about, I think all in the room, innovation means newness, unique. How many hands up for that? I think almost everybody, right? So that part was there. How many thought, innovation means experience, messaging? Hardly, just one or two, right? So Archana, obviously you're the disruptor and innovative definition of innovation. Why don't you just explain that a bit more to the audience?
So yeah, to begin with, you have to stand out. So if there are panelists, you have to stand out as a disruptor.
That she was proving
that's the first. That's the first lesson in branding and advertising, whatever be the medium. So when I say experience and when I say EQ, which is emotional quotient, I'll give you by way of example. In 2017, when IPL was launched, the whole ad campaign of Manu Ranjan ka baap aa raha hai. It resonated with a lot of us, and the way it was created, that was an experience. No tool was used, it was only content, and I represent content and the imagination and innovation in content. So one is that it was an experience which was led by content and creativity. So when we are talking about innovation in advertising in television, it's very important to also talk about content creativity in the messaging.
So you mean creativity and messaging is innovation, is
yes.
That what you were saying? Okay, so let's lead that to understand what really in today's day and age is very commonly known for ad content innovation in television. What is it? I think it's the characters, the influencer marketing piece.
Yeah.
So I think we all know that influencer marketing is becoming bigger, and television protagonists are stand for something, right? So I think some of you can even share some examples. But the question I'm posing to each one of you is that, and Lakshmi, you can take that because you're from television. How important is influencer marketing on television, and what do you think is more important? Like in Bollywood, it's very often seen that you use Salman Khan, Amitabh Bachchan, and Shah Rukh, etc., not in their character avatars, but in their persona avatars. But on television, obviously, most of the brands seem to obviously connect with their character, because the character is what is known, not the person. So your comments on it, and others can then add on.
Yeah. To me, television is all about plot and character, and not so much of stories, and purely because you see all the fictions running. We have about 300 fiction shows running, more than 500 episodes. The storyline moves at a pace which is pretty slow, but characters resonate with these with the consumer, and they look up to them. There are communities being created basis love, trust, so on so forth, and they believe in these characters. They aspire, they're aspirational for them. So hence for me, characters work beautifully with in terms of innovation.
But today's characters, aren't they like in multiple serials, etc., like most prominent
that's
characters?
That's the reason why I'm saying not the influencer, but the character in their avatar.
Okay.
Okay, so for example, Kumkum Kundli protagonist in their avatar works beautiful with that audience set, because they look up to them, they want to ape them. There is a community built around those characters.
So do you see a con there that when you use a character and suppose an audience who does not even watch that Kum Kum serial, is it meant only for TV? Is it restrictive to TV then?
It's largely TV audience set. For example, I would give a case in point being L'Oreal, L'Oreal Total Repair. Aishwarya is their brand ambassador.
Yes.
But they still wanted to do something more in Maharashtra because trust was an issue which they were facing.
Sure.
And what we did with our characters, the five characters which resonated with that Maharashtrian household or Marathi speaking household, we did not only the vignettes or ads with them, but also within the show. And their scores moved phenomenally.
I think
phenomenally.
We all have heard this case, right? Most of us have heard this case, quite talked about. And like we rightly said, that it's predominantly restricted to the audience which watches them. For example, it means nothing to me.
In today's day and world, it's not just about TV, it's an and world. So yeah. What we do is, whatever is also there on TV, we see that they're socially also relevant, whether we take a bit of it on Instagram Facebook and so on, so of the relevant serials.
So Mohit, you can add, but I think since you work on Swiggy, I think content and messaging beyond character, if you want to add on character, you do, but take on from there for your whole context yeah. And you know how Swiggy is really done a great job with cricket.
So one thing on the content piece I'll just add, many years back when Hyundai was launching e-on, it was a category, it was a very unique car. We had tied up with Sony and we had used 10 of their characters from different shows, and we created a content for Hyundai. And as you said, one of the con is that if one specific character is not being watched or the show is not being watched by somebody, then they will not associate, which is why a wider character set is required for you to manage the entire...
That's a nice thought. Yeah. I think some brands have focused on one character, but I hear you say that even L'Oreal has taken five, which is a good tip for the audience, I think.
Absolutely.
So very nice. Okay.
And, on the... in innovation, any innovation, context is very important, as we discussed.
Yeah.
And that's where I'll give the example of Swiggy, where, context can also be driven by technology today, because especially for brands like Swiggy, which are technology driven, context becomes very important. So last year, while they do a lot of regular innovations on cricket, we did a tech integration on Hotstar, where the app was embedded in the Hotstar app itself. And it was very meaningful for the consumers because they did not have to go out of the cricket viewing environment to order Swiggy. So they could just order Swiggy on the site. So that's where context becomes very important, and technology is driving and helping you with driving the context. So
you
want to add to that?
Take it from the whole, he spoke about the journey of an influencer from just being the face of the brand to actually delivering the brand values. And that's what we did at UpGrad, where Vicky Kaushal was our face of the brand. He was a brand ambassador in 2019. And in 2020, we've kind of gone ahead and made him the person who's delivering the value, as he delivers something called a stand-up book, which is, from the UpGrad's point of view, it is about making sure that you are learning, making learning a habit by reading a book. So these days brands are not just using influencers just to be the face, but also making them deliver the brand positioning.
Also, somewhere this whole debate about authenticity of celebrities is a big thing that's happening, today. So how does that solve for this? Does that solve for this? What's your view, Pamit? I mean, does it solve for this using micro influencers? Actually, they're not micro, they're very mass, but still they're not like as big as the, A-plus celebs that we talk about in terms of Bollywood.
Yeah, in fact, I'd venture to say that the A-plus celebs are increasingly harder to associate your brand with because they're associated to so many brands. So there's just so much of confusion in the mind of the consumers that unless you're really pumping in a lot of money, the chances of people associating your brand to the values that an A-plus celebrity... I like the idea of what you were calling micro... Let's call them micro-celebrities or television leads and all of that. Because they're a lot more... they're a lot closer to home. They're a lot more girl next door, boy next door kind of thing.
It's real life.
And yeah, they do lend authenticity. My only concern, to kind of spin this conversation a little bit is... You need to be doing this for not the purpose of just novelty. I mean, if novelty is the objective, then there are 100 things you can do in a typical
FCD. Yeah, but meaningfulness is at its core. And we'll come to that when we talk about success measurement and stuff like that. Let's now move on to talking about, you know, what's really the gamut of innovation on television as per us, and some of you can talk about how you see that moving towards future. And the question is around the spin that, you know, more and more we see that when we look at TV innovation cases, are we really looking at television in isolation, or it's also an and medium today? So is digitization really coming across so much into the television world at all also? And how do we see that, being so important that television actually is no longer television innovation? So your views, Lakshmi.
TV advertising is energized by tech, actually. If you look at whatever the innovation today is happening, is also energized largely by tech. Case in point being, it was considered a passive medium. Today, we're looking at making it an offline to an online medium. So we recently did a QR code-led activity with Flipkart, wherein the protagonists, whatever they were wearing or whatever the kitchen scenes were, if you wanted to order, you just click on the QR code. It took you to the microsite of Flipkart, and
so
you could
like
buy
just,
it directly.
Just restricted to Z as technology?
As of now, yes. It's an in-house technology which we have built in, okay. Which maybe anybody and everybody can do it. But that's how. But more important is what it's adding is it's allowing you to do call to action, a response-led, which TV was not known for. For example, currently most of the real estate clients have started coming on to TV, which was not TV's forte at some point.
So that's so something Z which also is solved for another problem, not just Z, some other networks, which again would be TV innovation for solving for a marketer's problem of geo-targeting.
Yes.
Somehow it hasn't clicked too well, right? Would you call that
no,
a success story, and why not?
Largely concerns is, again, you could call it, there is no measurement in place. A measurement to that extent, and which is where the marketeers are used to end of the day numbers to de do types.
Okay.
And that's something which is not taken off to that extent, but there are it's still working for certain clients, and there is repeat purchase on with those by
so
splitting.
While thanks Lakshmi, so while this tech innovation that you, why I was talking about success and not so much success of Amagi and stuff, the way you all deal with geo-targeting was that, is this new thing that you're talking about also, is it restricted to just tactical innovations, or is there some strategic intent there you see? And is there a framework that, Mohit, you would like to talk about when you look at it from a client side? What is strategic innovation and what is tactical long-term versus short-term? Would you take a
talk? I think, long-term innovation is always something that builds the core of the brand, as I was talking about, and builds meaningfulness. So we have our own research which can actually track meaningfulness of a brand over years. And if the meaningfulness scores go up, then I can clearly say that an innovation has worked in delivering that. But most of the time, where the objective is to deliver results, then at the end of the campaign, you tend to deviate and do things which are very tactical in nature, which are giving you results then and there, maybe not building the core of the brand,
so
which I feel is not innovation in the true sense, but then again, it is being qualified as an innovation today.
Sure, yeah, because I think innovation changes with time, right? So today, what you're talking about, I don't know how long this will last, the life cycle, I probably will be very, very slow, and very, very fast rather, because doing QR code or even without a QR code, trying to make it, it's almost like digital banners and ads having a buy button. So if that starts, then does that remain innovation is the question. What's your view, Arjun?
Yeah, so I'll take up from what you said and what Lakshmi said, that is it television alone? And actually, what is television? It's just a screen, because you have connected televisions also, which is a different ball game altogether. So it has to be a competitive collaboration and collaborative partnership kind of a stance that agencies, clients, and people who are creating should have. That means I'll have to blend it and bundle it the way it is most experiential. Again, I'm coming to that. Because at the end of the day, I have to, if Z is doing this whole element of five, where the sense of smell, the sense of touch, the sense of if there's a chef who's cooking and I can smell the food, and that's where technology is going to lead us to, that means it's going to really take a lot of leap. And that's only just 3 or 4 years from here onwards. So innovation has to be really put on, made to stand on its head if we have to really wow the audience. And it has to be collaborative, it has to be experiential.
Is this work in progress at Z's end?
Yeah, it should take us some time, but we are in the testing phase.
Okay, and is this like already there in the US or what? I mean, this whole 5 senses piece where touch, smell, etc.
No, it's not there. It's we're working with the US partner, so hopefully we should be able
but
to.
But you filed the IP. Yeah, they filed the IP, so that means it's there.
Very nice, very interesting. So, TV, how important other than this is tech? Any other examples? Would you like to share anything that Mohit, you guys have done on tech-led stuff, or mainly Swiggy?
So we've done it across. For Quikr also, we had done tech innovation. So again, tech innovations have to be done for tech clients, because at the end of the day, and I think you're, it's also a function of whether the client buys into the innovation or not.
Yeah.
So I think that's a very important debate.
Yes. I think we should throw that up to how many agencies sitting here and how many clients? Agencies, hands up. Besides me, very few. Clients? Good. And channels? Superb. So I'll throw the question first to the audience, that do you think agencies have the capability, and good, there are not too many agencies here. Do you think agencies have the ability and the power to sell innovation to clients? And I want hands up from the
clients.
Just 2 of you out of many more hands that were there earlier. And what about channels? What's the answer? Do agencies have the power and ability to sell it, your innovation, or you have to do it yourself? Nobody's talking, nobody's... No hands up? No? So Mohit, you want to talk about it?
Yeah, so I think it is and. So it's a, agency and as a channel partner and the client. All three of them, any one of them is not able to sell, and the whole thing falls flat. You know, people can make so much of a difference. I've seen it in our own agency. The same client, one team, there was a set of innovations that were happening. Another team, which is more aggressive, and the innovations or the level of innovation suddenly changes. So at the same, the client was the same, but the people at the agency end had changed, and hence the output had changed. So all three of them work very closely.
One is it's a client specific. It is also people specific.
Absolutely.
And I think people specific, what's interesting is it's also the client. I think in the agency, we all always say, Inko innovation bechna hi mushkil hai. Unko to innovation nahi chahiye. You know, there are certain clients that are known for, yes, no? I mean, do
clients
we see that? Certain clients are known for wanting innovation. So that brings me to the next question. That why does that happen? One is personality, but I think we can't be at the quirks of, though sometimes we are, but we shouldn't be at least at the quirks or of personality. I think there's a way to solve for that, and I think that's on KPI setting. You want to take that up? That how does KPI setting become so important, that if the client's KPIs and agency KPIs, what do you say? Like, innovation needs to be, is it there on a client KPI first?
Good question. I think it depends on how much...
And I mean relevance, of course. I don't mean for the sake of innovation, but yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I see, the simple thing as far as I'm concerned is failure is important to be able to innovate successfully. So someone mentioned, I think you were talking about the QR code thing not kicking off. That's good. That means there's something that we're probably missing in some part of the journey. Either maybe the messaging wasn't right. Maybe the particular problem that was being sought to be solved was not right. So coming to client, this whole client versus agency, let's figure out who's whether it's their fault or our fault. I think the truth of the matter is a lot of clients are answerable to VCs, and there's a lot of performance pressure, especially in today's economic climate. It's not necessarily the right thing to ask or expect of clients to start getting innovative all the time.
Sure.
And you need to be able to, I mean, that's where agencies, so-called partner capabilities come into picture. There is a timing for things. You can't be expecting clients to shell out, but I'd expect that, like what I used to try and do, for example, at shadi.com, was that we tried to keep about 10 to 20% of our overall media budgets separately for experimentation. A lot of the experimentation was not necessarily on television. It was BTL or whatever. So the
The point you mentioned on the VC answerability, etc. Because of innovation? Is it always because of corner room attention? Is it when the top management really wants it? Is that something?
It's a very big factor. I mean, the top management is obviously got a much more strategic view of things.
He has something else to say. Tell us.
I mean, I wouldn't expect that it happens without top management consent.
I have a different take on it. In today's day and age, there is too much of clutter and everybody wants to, come out and, make a noise.
Stand out.
And in this scenario, I would say if I am the broadcaster, I know my products well and I know what clients' issues are and then showcase whatever I have in my kitty and say, okay, this matches well and this is what the brand should do. I guess the brand is open to, and maybe the agency comes on board if he sees merit and value in it. So for me, value is the critical word which applies for the brand as well as value to the organization.
So let me just put some flesh to this, right? Let's just discuss this one level deeper. Let's say, for example, my problem is that I don't have excessive outlays. I don't want to outlay more than, let's say, 1 crore. Very, very, cash trap kind of budget. And I'm saying that I just have 1 crore, now figure out how do I advertise. Yeah. Amagi could have been a good innovation for me.
Which is what, right? I was discussing before coming
exactly.
here.
Exactly. I mean, that's why I asked you the question about, so I could simply say that, okay, fine, let me now innovate because I'll target only Mumbai because Mumbai isn't big enough market. And although my cost per reach and some of the other metrics are going to completely haywire, my outlay is actually much lower. So innovation is not necessarily about the message or the format. It could be simply in terms of how you do media selection or media buying itself.
Mm-hmm. I'll just add one thing to it. I think why we fail to sell innovations to clients most of the time is because the objectives are different. The client has a very different objective. The client has an ROI objective. Now, agency is trying to do an innovation to get an award, right? And a channel is trying to do an innovation because they want revenue out of it. So many times our objectives are very different and hence we are not able to bring it together.
Yeah, but it's
into
so interesting, Mohit, that you said awards, because I mean, while we would all like awards, I mean, clients love awards. The day you get an award, clients themselves go berserk, right? They write internally, externally. So it's a great motivator. Awards is a great motivator for everybody, but somehow, it's just looked at that, okay, don't do it for that, which is not the point. We're never going to be doing something just for the sake of it. But I think awards is a great motivator, right? We all would agree to that, I'm sure.
So I'll want to add to this and this whole client agency ecosystem. Where is the customer in this and who owns the customer and who owns and who decides and who knows what the customers want? In this whole hyper dynamic state where the consumers are spoiled for choices.
Sure.
So I've seen a lot of discussions going about who decides what is an innovation, by the way. Innovation for some is incremental change. That's why it's a cuss word also sometimes. So who's deciding and who knows what the customers want and who's tapping the daily changed needs of the customer and the behavior?
Sure.
Is a very, very interesting element which a lot of us forget most of the times.
Yeah, sure. So I think tapping into it, and finally it's all about ROI in whichever way. Now ROI can be measured in various ways, right? From even an award could be an ROI. Like, I did this and did I get an award? Did I get, noticed by people? Or did I get, X number of calls? Or did I get so many website visits, etc.? So that brings us to the last question that I'm going to pose, which is on measurability. Now, what are some of the common ways, and I think each one of you could talk about in your experience, what are some measurable outcomes that TV innovation has driven through examples, if possible? That'll be great. I think anyone can start with that.
For us, the recent example being Byju's, when the need was downloads, because they're very clear that they don't want to do advertising for the sake of advertising. It's pure play downloads. And that's where we did a lot of deep integration within the content and across. And there was huge number of downloads in repeating that exercise across. So for them, it's like clear. So every client has a different ask. There is some who wants to look at the score in terms of trust quotient or for that matter,
like
awareness.
Like you said, the L'Oreal was a trust.
Or
example.
A retention.
It
depends.
In terms of measurability, I guess somewhere it's... you are in a better off position if you're a digital product. Like ours was a digital product, even OneAssist is a digital insurance service provider. So if it's a digital product, measurability becomes
like
very easy.
Like she said, Baiju's, and I think exactly. You were at so Shadi.com and there was
absolutely, with Shadi.com every time, you know, you did. In terms of whether the innovation is driving it or not is a slightly more nuanced question, but there are analytical tools available to figure that out. So it's easy to measure. I don't know how it would play out in an offline kind of, let's say a retail. I'm guessing measurability in terms of walk-ins for retail would be something that, what I know from friends in FMCG is that they kind of try and measure primary and secondary sales with some kind of a time lag kind of built into it. Pre and post, but these pre and post analysis are very, the problem with it and, you know, with pre and post is that there's this macro seasonality associated to it, which you have to kind of count. So you know, those analysis tend to be a little looser.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, in terms of measurability, depending on the kind of category you are in, it's easier or harder.
So since we are talking about measurability, I think the language of business is revenue. So if whatever innovation you are doing by way of brand, messaging, innovation, experience, if it is leading to more business, more revenue, that's where the buck stops and ends, right? So while we have, like at UpGrad also, we have this whole data analytics and loads of data being crunched and massaged to know what's working, what's not working. But the proof to the pudding is that if I did this messaging and what was the impact on the revenue, that's the only measurability.
Trust was another soft factor, but yeah, I think buzz is also another one.
Yeah, I agree with them. While, you know, in an ideal situation, trust, meaningfulness should go up over a period of time, but then you don't have that time. End of the day, the innovation happens and they want to look at the business results. So even for Swiggy, for that matter, the tech innovation, the final result was how many orders were being driven of that engagement. So maybe that's the way the language is changing. Yeah. In
which is why if we to ask you what the TV innovation of Swiggy versus the tech innovation of Swiggy, probably the tech innovation would have scored equal or higher,
absolutely.
Right? So because
absolutely.
The business... So I think we have just three more minutes or so. Can we... throw the house open for questions, if any.
And then there's none.
We solved all the questions. We answered everything for you.
Were there any questions at all, is the question. Anything else? You guys want to talk anything else about any examples? Anything else that you think I've missed up on?
So I will just want to, since we are kind of in a concluding stance, television advertising and the fact that we are talking about television first means that there is a need to reinvent ourselves, and hence this community is meeting. Hence there is a need to think of innovation, think of relevance in future. So that is a very big message, that how are we evolving, staying relevant and earning our relevance every day, and employing all kinds of mediums, tools, technology, creativity, and everything else that makes for the magic potion. And that's what is important right now.
Sure. So TV and, like I said. Great, yeah. You have a mic there? Someone's going to... You can, yeah, no problem. Any particular person you want to address the question?
There has to be a buy-in from, like you mentioned, the client side, the agency side as well. If all of them are, let's say, convinced on the idea, I think what also happens is there's a certain BAU or there's a certain way of functioning that is already in place. A lot of times, innovation has to perhaps take out a certain pie from what has been happening and still deliver the certain business metrics that the original plan was delivering. So a certain X plan delivering Y results. Now X may say 10% has to come out, or 50% has to come out, and then still, you know, the expectation from the client is that the Y delivery will still be maintained. How can this gap be bridged whenever you're selling the idea, or what kind of innovation should Y be changed? Should the expectation be lower or higher? And how should this be pitched when the entire selling of innovation proposition is happening?
I think we should start with the why. So in the sense that, we have to start bottoms up. Unfortunately, we go top down. We have something and we start pushing it down clients and that's how it happens. But if we do bottoms up, if we know the why and then recreate the entire, customize the entire innovation for delivering that why, I think we'll do our job. So we have to reinvent ourselves. That's essentially what we have to do.
We have to change the selling
Certainly
process.
Certainly the why should be bigger. I mean, innovation means itself. Why else would somebody buy it? If it has to give a similar yield to the X, then you won't buy it. You can't sell it. The selling point is always that it will deliver. The point is that it's always a risk. Nobody can promise and guarantee, and that's where the trick is. That how do you quantify that gap of whatever? I don't even call it a gap. That's the plus that I would call it, because gap would be negative. It's never going to be a gap, hopefully, when you have a good idea which is relevant. But how much of it is there, and how do you kind of really get on the same page to your expectations being? So what is success, which is why we spoke about analytics and bars and awards and all of that. These things help, because these are the success metrics, basically. Yeah. I think for Mike, Jenna, please.
My question is, like you said, carrying it forward, that there's a risk and there is difficulty in measuring. If you're an online client, if you're a tech client, then maybe you can measure before offline, it's a problem. If that risk doesn't work for the client, then the ability to take these kind of innovation-based risks decreases. So my question, is there a way, can we get more creative in way of ensuring that if those KPIs are not met, then there will be a mutual,
You're talking about mitigating risks.
Mitigating risk, and if in case client is agreeing to do something which is not tried and tested and their money being put on the table, and if that doesn't work, then there is some kind of a reassurance from the other side. I think that can help for
certainly
the clients.
Certainly it can. I think channels sitting here would know that there are a lot of times the handholding happens, and there are understandings and stuff like that. Yeah, certainly it helps. Yeah, so the time is up. Well, I think we'll conclude. Thank you so much.